Well, maybe let's start here. What is quantum computing as distinct from classic computing, and why does it even matter?
So maybe a good place to start with is to realize, as powerful as computers have become, there is a list, actually a long list, of problems they cannot solve and actually will never solve. So quantum computers are a new computational modality that can complement what traditional computers can do. And that will help us in computations I would think really matter, like simulation of physical systems. It can help with solving optimization problems or key challenges in machine learning.
But give me an example of something that shows the distinction of what a classic computer would do versus what a quantum computer would do.
Okay, try something. So we are a search company. So let's discuss a search problem. Okay. And computer scientists, let's say the simplest search problem you can think of is unstructured search, where you pick one item out of N. So let's envision it in the following way. Imagine a huge closet with a million drawers. I take an item and I put it into one of those drawers. So your task is to find the item. So how many drawers will you have to open? Or how many algorithmic steps does that require?
Well, I'm going to go with an average rule. So I imagine probably at least 500,000 if you've got a stack of a million things. So I'd imagine 500,000.
Exactly. So in average, if it's random, if I place this item somewhere, sometimes I get lucky and open the first drawer and I find it, and sometimes I'm unlucky and I have to open 1,000,000 drawers. So on average, exactly right, it's 500,000. But as amazing as this may sound, I like to call this like a quantum koan, if this closet would be a quantum closet, or let's make it more realistically, if it would be a quantum memory, then you could find this item with certainty with only 1,000 steps, so only square root of 1,000,000.
Well, people in the audience are probably wondering, how is that possible in this world to go from, I'd predicted 500,000 to now 1,000? How in this world is that possible?
Exactly. So, yeah, how in this world is this possible? And the answer is, it's not possible in this world. This was not a trick question, but one key lesson from quantum physics is that there is not just this one world we experience right now. It rather suggests that there are many, many parallel worlds, and that we live in a multiverse, and that every object is really a multi-object. So somewhat esoterically speaking, you could say quantum computing is the first technology that takes this idea serious, and it farms out a computation into some of those parallel worlds as well to obtain the answer quicker.
Well, why don't you try with an example? Give an example of how, so that we can fully envision this.
So, yeah, I know this sounded a little bit like a German philosopher. I apologize.
Well, no, because I mean, it's very, when you talk about multiverse, it's very philosophical, but I'm trying to think, is there a practical way you could illustrate what you mean about these quantum states and multiple spaces you're talking about?
So yeah, for our project, of course, various things we want to achieve, but if I could only get one thing right, it would be the following. My wife and I, we have two boys as children, and I want them to enjoy the world as much as you and I had the opportunity to do. And in order to ensure this, we have to slow down climate change. We have to develop an energy economy that emits less CO2. So we need to find new ways to produce energy, transport energy, and store energy. And if we had a quantum computer, it would be a marvelous tool to design the technologies needed here. And of course, I'm aware we are racing the time. We need to build this machine and then give it to the engineers to do the other work.
So that's an example of what you might call a quantum advantage kind of problem that these quantum computers can help us solve. Yes. But tell us, what is it going to take to actually build these systems and build these quantum computers? What are the key things we have to get right? I mean, you've been working on this for a while now.
Yeah, so I know some of you will have the opportunity to see actually the quantum AI labs down the street, and you can see the status where we are. So the mission of our team is to build a large, useful quantum computer with about 1 million physical qubits. So today, we have 100 qubits, so there is some ways to go, but we hope to get there by the end of this decade.
What's a qubit? Explain that.
So a qubit, if you allow me before answering right. this, I think one message I would like the audience to take home is because you often read a little bit otherwise in the media. Our team at this stage is very confident that we will build a large quantum computer. So sometimes there's still questions whether that's even possible.
Yeah. Right, but why don't you explain what a qubit is? I'd like to come back to this question. So what are, you know, the progress you and your team are making, but just to help us understand.
Yeah, so a qubit, let me try two metaphors to not make it too metaphorically. So if you're very simple-minded, you describes the world in single bits, so black or white. If you're a little bit more sophisticated, you realize, oh, wait, there are shades of gray in between. But if you're a quantum computing person, you put black and white on the poles of a globe, of a sphere, and you realize, oh, all intermediate states between black and white are actually states on the sphere. Yeah, so this is one metaphor. Let me try another one. Often when you read about qubits in newspapers, they say, oh, a qubit can be in zero or one or black and white. It's the same moment, and people scratch their head. How is that possible? I think it's easier to understand if you consider a few bits. So what I often like to do is I pull out a few coins, throw them on the table, and then say, oh, look, there's one classical configuration. Let's say heads, heads, heads. But again, quantum mechanics would tell us if you want to properly describe it, even though it's imperceptible to us, the other configurations, in this case would be eight other configurations with three coins.
So 2^3, right, with three coins.
Exactly, it would be 2^3. And you have to consider all these configurations in order to properly describe the system. And here you get also a whiff where the exponential power of supercomputers, of quantum computers comes from. If you had a fourth coin, it would already be 16 possible configurations. And if you have n qubits, it would be 2^n configurations, which tends to be a huge exponential numbers. And all those states can be processed in a single time step inside a quantum computer.
That's very cool. So you're clear. I mean, this year has been a fascinating year when it comes to quantum computing. I think one of the Nobel Prizes actually went to the three scientists who did work on quantum entanglement. One of the things that often comes up with quantum computing, Hartmut, is the concerns that people have about a whole range of things. I mean, some people in the room may know, for example, Shor's algorithm. So this is an algorithm that was actually devised in the 90s by, you know, Shor, a scientist called Shor, which basically suggested that if you could have a quantum computer, you could actually do what's called prime number factorization. And a lot of our encryption systems rely basically on our ability to make it very, very difficult, the classic computer, to actually factorize prime numbers. But he showed that if you had a quantum computer, you could actually do that. So one of the concerns that people have is, in fact, you know, will this just mess up all our encryption, security, privacy systems? So from a responsible innovation standpoint, how are you thinking about that question, or those kinds of questions that people may have either concerns or worries about?
So they have some good news in the sense that computer scientists at governments, academia, and companies they're quite aware of the problem you describe, and they have been busy developing encryption protocols that are immune to quantum attack. So once we have the big useful quantum computer, encryption by that time will change, and our data will still be safe. Actually, the National Institute of Standards and Technology this summer, they published four suggested protocols to keep data safe in the age of quantum computers.
Right. But you're also thinking about other aspects of being responsible, and in fact, including questions about either jobs and inclusivity. Say more about what you're thinking about with regards to those other aspects of being responsible for these situations.
One key aspect for our field is workforce development. So in some ways, it's good. Quantum technologies, not just quantum computing, but quantum technologies overall are a job creator, and we create more jobs than we can currently fill, and that's also true for our team at Google. And in quantum computing, similar to many other STEM fields, there's still a lack of diversity, let's say, along gender or other dimensions of diversity, and of course we would like to improve on this. And that's maybe a little call to action to the audience. So if you have a young student in your vicinity, maybe point them to quantum information science as an interesting career path to take.
So at the start of this conversation, Hardwin and I described this as the fast approaching future. So do you have a view on when we can expect fully functional quantum computers?
So our plan right now calls for finishing this by the end of this decade, when we will be able to handle commercial workloads. Again, interesting discoveries already made today, but to have a solid quantum computing service that third parties can access, this will be done, I hope, before this decade ends.
Well, I tried to talk Hartman into giving us a demo, but he said, no, in fact, what we'll do instead, we'll do a field trip. So I think some of you signed up to do a field trip to his lab to actually see some of what he's building. So hopefully we'll do that later this afternoon. Some of you will join us for that. But this is fascinating, Hartman. Every time I have a conversation with you, I'm reminded of, you mentioned Richard Feynman. I mean, Richard Feynman has this famous quote when he said something along the lines of, if you think you understand quantum computing, you don't understand quantum computing. And I always end up feeling that way, but thank you.
Thank you.